Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. Today, we are going over the process and safeguards for maintaining privacy and confidentiality, presented by myself, David Eric Lopez, and Danielle Raghib. This is for part of the M-TAC project, and it is sponsored by the Department, California Department of Healthcare Services. A disclaimer, this presentation was prepared for the Medi-Cal Mobile Crisis Training and Technical Assistance Center, also known as M-TAC, which is funded by the California Department of Healthcare Services and administered by the Center for Applied Research Solutions, also known as CARS. All material appearing in this presentation, except that taken directly from copyrighted sources, is in the public domain and may be reproduced or copied without permission from DHCS or the authors. Citation of the source is appreciated. Do not reproduce or distribute this presentation for a fee without specific written authorization from the M-TAC project. This presentation is recorded and will be posted to our website. Conflict of interest disclosures, both myself and Danielle have certified that we have no relevant relationships with any commercial or nonprofit organizations that represent a conflict of interest. The mobile crisis services, the mobile crisis services provide rapid response, individual assessment, and community-based stabilization to Medi-Cal members who are experiencing a behavioral health crisis. Mobile crisis services are designed to provide relief to members experiencing a behavioral health crisis, including through de-escalation and stabilization techniques. And the goal is to reduce the immediate risk of danger and subsequent harm, avoid unnecessary emergency department care, psychiatric inpatient hospitalizations, and law enforcement involvement. This is all directed and guided by from the Behavioral Health Information Notice 23-025, page 3. And with this whole new benefit, the direction for mobile crisis services is we hope to change the mobile crisis services so that the response is more resolution focused and works to provide relief to the people in crisis in the community. The goal is to support people in crisis where they are while using the least restrictive means necessary. This new direction for mobile crisis services should be person-centered, trauma-informed, equity-driven, provide a brief intervention, including de-escalation and remain resolution focused, working from a lens of a least restrictive intervention, be culturally responsive, linguistically appropriate, and accessible. And welcome. I am David Lopez, and I'll turn it over to Danielle, and we are both with the Center for Applied Research Solutions. If you want to say hi, Danielle.
Hi, thank you. My name is Danielle Raghib, and I am also a technical assistance specialist working on the M-TAC project, and I am from the Center for Applied Research Solutions as well.
Thanks, Danielle. Okay, so today we're going to be going over a few different learning objectives regarding this. By attending this training, participants will be able to understand the Behavioral Health Information Notice, BHIN 23-025, requirements for maintaining privacy and confidentiality. We're going to review the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act, HIPAA, and 42 CFR Part 2, as they relate to mobile crisis teams as healthcare providers and sharing protected information during crisis situations. Goal is to increase their knowledge of best practices and legal standards for exchanging protected health information when coordinating with other delivery systems of care. BHIN 23-025, maintaining privacy and confidentiality. The general guidance. General guidance, the state of California encourages a multidisciplinary coordination of care for people receiving treatment and services in California. There's a growing consensus in the healthcare community that such integrated whole person care improves treatment outcomes, reduces inefficient use of healthcare resources, and increases patient satisfaction and safety. At the same time, the state acknowledges the importance of protecting the privacy of patients and the confidentiality of healthcare information. Many patients have needlessly experienced the pain of ostracization or discrimination due to the inappropriate disclosure of health information regarding their mental health or substance use disorder treatments. Protecting patients from this type of violation of their privacy rights is the driving force behind the special regulatory protections for mental health and SUD patients' healthcare records and information. And this is gathered from the State Health Information Guidance, page 70. Privacy and confidentiality. Mobile crisis teams shall maintain the privacy and confidentiality of their patients' information in accordance with federal and state law. Mobile crisis teams typically will be healthcare providers subject to the privacy and security rules under the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act, also known as HIPAA, while mobile crisis teams and Medi-Cal behavioral health delivery systems will often be able to exchange protected health information in compliance with HIPAA, Medi-Cal behavioral health systems shall be aware of HIPAA requirements that may limit mobile crisis teams' ability to share such information, such as HIPAA's minimum necessary requirement. Privacy and confidentiality. In addition, there may be circumstances where mobile crisis teams are subject to the Federal Substance Use Disorder Confidentiality Regulation, known as 42 CFR Part 2. Medi-Cal behavioral health delivery systems shall inquire whether any of their mobile crisis teams are subject to 42 CFR Part 2, and if so, ensure that workflows are in place to ask members for their consent when appropriate. If the member is being served through a Cal AIM initiative, some additional data sharing is permissible that might otherwise have been restricted under California law. For further information, Medi-Cal behavioral health delivery systems should consult with the Cal AIM data authorization guidance. The link is listed in the slide. State Health Information Guidance. The State Health Information Guidance, SHIG, is a publication released in April of 2023 by the California Health and Human Service Agency, CalHHS. The SHIG combines general guidance and field-based scenarios to clarify federal and state behavioral health laws related to sharing mental health information and substance use disorder patient identifying information. The SHIG offers authoritative guidance to provide legal clarification for sharing patient information while protecting patient privacy. Removing obstacles may result in increased coordination of care to help patients achieve better health outcomes, but coordination of care requires patient information to be shared in an appropriate, secure, and timely manner between different types of health providers. Some guiding principles for sharing behavioral health information. Patient access principle. A patient generally has the right to inspect, review, and obtain copies of his or her behavioral health information, and a provider must enable such patient access. Patient right to be informed, the principle. A patient generally has the right to be informed of a provider's practices regarding uses and disclosures of his or her healthcare information. Principles for sharing behavioral health information. The SHIG provides the following principles for sharing behavioral health information. The following general principles are considered foundational by the state of California for sharing behavioral health information and records. Coordination of care principle. Behavioral health information should be shared by providers to the extent allowed by federal and state laws to address patient care needs involving medical, behavioral, and socioeconomic issues. Information blocking principle. Intentionally not sharing behavioral health information that can be legally and ethically shared to benefit the patient is strongly discouraged. Information blocking is prohibited for healthcare providers, health IT developers of certified health IT, health information exchanges, and health information networks as defined in 45 CFR Part 171.102 under the Information Blocking Rule of the 21st Century Cures Act. That link is listed below. Information blocking is prohibited for healthcare providers, health IT developers of health certified health IT and health information exchanges, and health information networks as defined in 45 CFR Part 171.102 under the Information Blocking Rule of 21st Century Cures Act. The U.S. Department of Health and Human Services Office of Inspector General published a final rule to establish civil money penalties authorized by the Cures Act that applies to health IT developers, certified health IT, entities offering certified health IT, health information exchanges, and health information network. If the Office of Inspector General determines that one of these entities has committed information blocking, they may be subject to up to a $1 million penalty per violation. For further information regarding information blocking, that link is listed on this slide. Principles for sharing behavioral health information. Patient right to authorized disclosure of healthcare information principle. A patient has a right to authorized disclosure of his or her behavioral health information. An adult patient generally may provide permission for a health provider or organization to share his or her personal healthcare information, including behavioral health records, for a wide variety of purposes. When in the best interest of the patient and allowed by the law, the state strongly encourages the exchange or disclosures of information. Even when federal and state statutes and regulation prohibit disclosures of health information unless unauthorized, behavioral health providers are encouraged to discuss with patients why authorizing a disclosure or the sharing of information may be in the patient's best interest. Examples might include situations where a patient can authorize disclosure and sharing of information to encourage collaboration and integrated care between SUD treatment programs, behavioral health providers, physical health entities, and providers of social services. Generally applicable guidance. Minimum necessary when information is requested, used, or disclosed. Minimum necessary when health information is requested, used, or disclosed. Steps must be taken to limit the information to only what is relevant and necessary to accomplish the intended purpose. HIPAA requires disclosure of health information to be limited to the minimum necessary in many circumstances. While the minimum necessary requirement only applies to HIPAA regulated health information, other laws operate in similar way to limit disclosures. For example, disclosure of 42 CFR Part 2 regulated SUD patient identifying information must be limited to the information that is necessary to carry out the purpose of the disclosure. The minimum necessary requirement in HIPAA does not apply to the following exceptions. Other laws do. Disclosures to request by healthcare provider for treatment purposes. Disclosures made to the patient who is subject of the record when requested or required. Uses or disclosures made pursuant to a valid patient authorization. Disclosures to the Secretary of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. Uses or disclosures required by state or federal law. 42 CFR. Additional city code. Documentation requirements for authorized disclosures. Documentation requirements for authorized disclosures. Specific documentation must be created and maintained for disclosures of patient health information regulated by 42 CFR Part 2 or LPS, even when authorized by the patient with the general designation. This section covers documentation disclosures that are in response to an authorization. Note that HIPAA does not require an accounting of disclosures that are pursuant to an authorization. For more information about For more information about accounting of disclosures as required by HIPAA, refer to 45 CFR 164.528. Redisclosure of 42 CFR Part 2 CMIA and LPS patient information. Redisclosure of 42 CFR Part 2 CMIA and LPS patient information. Health and SUD patient identifying information regulated by 42 CFR Part 2 or CMIA is specifically protected and once received may only be redisclosed under specific conditions. Patient information regulated by 42 CFR Part 2 that identifies a patient directly or indirectly as having been diagnosed, treated, or referred for treatment for an SUD requires each disclosure be made with written consent from a patient or a patient's representatives unless disclosure meets an exception in the law. In addition, the recipient of the SUD patient identifying information cannot further disclose the information unless the further disclosure is expressly permitted by an authorization or as otherwise permitted by 42 CFR Part 2. While the LPS is silent on redisclosure, the privacy protections contained within the LPS continue with the further information, even once the information has disclosed. Further disclosure of LPS regulated information must meet an exception with the LPS or be with patient authorization. Psychotherapy notes. While psychotherapy notes are referenced in HIPAA, they are not referenced in California law. Based on HIPAA, psychotherapy notes may generally not be released without patient authorization. De-identified information and limited data set. To protect patient privacy while providing useful healthcare data, alternative approaches are permitted by current federal and state statutes and regulations. Alternative approaches include the use of de-identified information or a limited data set. The HIPAA privacy rule specifies two methodologies to adequately de-identify health information. One, a written determination by a qualified expert, or two, the removal of specific individual identifiers as well as the absence of actual knowledge by the covered entity that the remaining information could be used alone or in combination with other information to identify the individuals. Some examples of this include name, street addresses, telephone and fax number, email addresses, social security numbers, medical record numbers, health plan beneficiary numbers, account numbers, license certification numbers, and so on. Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act, also known as HIPAA. HIPAA, the standards for privacy of individual identifiable health information privacy rule establishes for the first time a set of national standards for the protection of certain health information. The U.S. Department of Health and Human Services issued the privacy rule to implement the requirement of a Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act of 1996. The privacy rule standards address the use and disclosures of individuals' health information called protected health information by organizations subject to the privacy rule called covered entities, as well as standards for individual privacy rights to understand and control how their health information is used. Within HHS, the Office for Civil Rights, or OCR, has responsibility for implementing and enforcing the privacy rule with respect to voluntary compliance activities and civil money penalties. What information is protected by HIPAA? A major goal of the privacy rule is to assure that individuals' health information is properly protected while allowing the flow of health information needed to provide and promote high quality healthcare and to protect the public's health and well-being. The rule strikes a balance that permits important uses of information while protecting the privacy of people who seek care and healing. Given that the healthcare marketplace is diverse, the rule is designed to be flexible and comprehensive to cover the variety of uses and disclosures that need to be addressed. The privacy rule protects all individual identifiable health information held or transmitted by a covered entity or its business associate in any form or media, whether electronic, paper, or oral. The privacy rule calls this information protected health information, also known as PHI. What information is protected by HIPAA? Personal Identifiable Health Information, or PHI, is information including demographic data that relates to the individual's past, present, or future physical or mental health condition, the provision of healthcare to the individual, or the past, present, or future payment for the provision of healthcare to the individual, and that identifies the individual or for which there is a reasonable basis to believe it can be used to identify the individual. Individually identifiable health information includes many common identifiers, including name, address, birth date, social security number. The privacy rule excludes from protected health information employment records that a covered entity maintains in its capacity as an employer and education and other certain records subject to or defined in the Family Educational Rights and Privacy Act, 20 U.S.C. Code 1232G. Types of data protected by HIPAA. Both written documentation and all paper records are protected. Spoken and verbal information, including voicemail messages, electronic databases, and any electronic information, including research information containing PHI, stored on a computer, smartphone, memory card, USB drive, or other electronic device, photographic images, and audio and video recordings. Privacy. A notice of health information privacy practices may be given to and be readily available to all members who receive mobile crisis services. A notice of health information privacy explains how the covered entity will use, disclose the patient's PHI, explains a patient's rights and where to file a complaint, is offered to a patient at the time of the first visit, patient should sign and date at the time of first visit, is posted on the facility's webpage and the patient reception area. The State of California Statutes, Confidentiality of Medical Information Act, CMIA, California Civil Code 56ETSEQ.11. This law protects the privacy of medical information by limiting disclosures by health providers, health plans, and contractors. Disclosure of limited health information, including location, general condition, or death, may be released to family members, other relatives, domestic partners, close personal friends, or other persons identified by the patient.
Thank you, David. Next, we're going to jump into HIPAA and mobile crisis services. So looking at how HIPAA plays into the world of mobile crisis services. All right, so the California Consumer Protection Act, known as CCPA, which is under the California Civil Code 1798.100, this law protects the privacy of consumers' personal information collected by for-profit businesses that meet certain threshold requirements for annual revenue or number of consumers of whom they receive, buy, sell, or share personal information. Health providers and information covered by either HIPAA or the CMIA is exempt from the CCPA requirements. All scenarios in the SHIG that David mentioned earlier assume that the CCPA does not apply. And we do have a link here in the slide for your reference. Sharing and releasing information. It is very important to know when and where members can request their PHI from the county, and be able to provide that information to them in the event they want to access their own PHI. Sharing and releasing information during or after a mobile crisis service encounter can be important in situations when the person in crisis might need further treatment and or for coordination with other delivery systems of care. So when a person in crisis is not able to remain safe in the community and or care for themselves and requires further treatment through either a warm handoff, and some examples are, you know, maybe they're transferred or transported to a crisis stabilization unit, a sobering center, a crisis respite center, or a psychiatric health facility, inpatient hospital, that PHI and confidential information will need to be shared with the receiving entity. In these cases, information sharing must follow all legal and ethical standards for confidentiality and the limits to confidentiality, and must abide by all legal, including both state and federal standards for sharing PHI. When coordinating care for referrals for ongoing services after the person is no longer in crisis, the person in crisis or parent legal guardian must provide consent for any release of or sharing of information. The mobile crisis team, again, must follow all legal and ethical standards for confidentiality and the limits to confidentiality, and must abide by all legal, both federal and state standards for sharing PHI. Privacy safeguards for mobile crisis teams. Some of the things that we want to do as providers in the field, sometimes we're in public places and we're in places where it's really hard to have private rooms or a place that is really protected. And so we want to avoid conversations involving PHI in public or common areas such as hallways or elevators. We want to keep documents containing PHI in locked cabinets, locked clipboards, or locked rooms when not in use. During work hours, place written materials in secure areas that are not in view or easily accessed by unauthorized persons. So we wouldn't want to leave someone's personal information or identifiable information sitting out on our desk, for example. We'd want to make sure that that is put away. Even though we're at work, it still needs to be in a secure area. Do not leave materials containing PHI on desks or counters, in conference rooms, on fax machines, printers, or in public areas. Do not remove PHI in any form from the designated worksite unless authorized to do so by management. Never take unauthorized photographs during a mobile crisis service encounter, including audio and video. Maintain security of all mobile devices, laptops, during and after an encounter. Carrying around PHI can be very tricky for mobile crisis teams, especially for mobile crisis teams. It's important that your county, if your county is still utilizing paper documentation, that when responding to a mobile crisis encounter, that you are provided with the appropriate materials to keep your documentation safe and secure. If your county uses laptops or tablets to complete documentation, then it's important that your county provides you the necessary equipment and software to ensure your devices are locked and stored safely when not in use. Next, we're moving on to CalAIM data sharing authorization. And we're going to go over a little bit of background. So CalAIM background. In 2022, the California Department of Healthcare Services launched the California Advancing and Innovating Medi-Cal, which also known as CalAIM, to transform and strengthen Medi-Cal, offering Californians a more equitable, coordinated, and person-centered system to help maximize their health and life trajectory. CalAIM integrates Medi-Cal members' care coordination and case management across physical health, behavioral health, and social service providers. This model focuses on the need for integrated care for members at various stages of risk and needs, while also providing care to members with the highest risk through enhanced care management and community supports. CalAIM builds upon the county-based whole person care pilots and plan-based health home programs that use whole person care approaches to address underlying social drivers of health. CalAIM envisions enhanced coordination, integration, and information exchange among managed care plans and among physical, behavioral, community-based organizations, social service providers, and county agencies. CalAIM data sharing guidance. CalAIM requires the exchange of information about Medi-Cal members, including an array of administrative, clinical, social, and human service information across all sectors. This exchange must occur in compliance with federal and state privacy laws, regulations, and other data sharing rules. That Cal AIM Data Sharing Authorization Guidance document, published in March of 2022, is intended to provide guidance that supports data sharing between MCPs, so managed care plans, healthcare providers, community-based social and human service providers, local health jurisdictions, and county and other public agencies that provide services and manage care under Cal AIM, collectively referred to as Cal AIM participants. All right, now we are moving on to confidentiality. Exceptions to confidentiality for behavioral health providers. This is a shorter list that is really relevant to mobile crisis teams, but these are some of the things that, as a behavioral health provider working in the field, these are some exceptions or what we call limits to confidentiality. So the person in crisis is a danger to themselves. So for example, they might be making suicidal threats or making threats to really harm themselves or harm someone else as well. So that could be the person is threatening to harm another specific person. Either they're threatening to kill them or assault them. This could potentially activate a duty to warn. So the Tarasoff law. So a duty to warn is we would need to warn the intended victim if there is one, and then also law enforcement. The person in crisis discloses any type of child abuse or neglect. This may also be disclosed by collaterals on site. So this may not be disclosed by the actual person in crisis, but maybe by a parent or caregiver or a sibling. And those are things that must be reported per mandate law. The person in crisis discloses any type of elder or dependent abuse. Again, this is also information that may not necessarily be disclosed by the actual person in crisis, but could be disclosed by a collateral on site. Code of Federal Regulations 42 CFR Part 2. 42 CFR Part 2. In addition to HIPAA, there are special privacy protections afforded to alcohol and drug abuse patient records under 42 CFR Part 2. The privacy provisions in 42 CFR Part 2 were motivated by the understanding that stigma and fear of prosecution might dissuade persons with substance use disorders from seeking treatment. And so we want to make sure that we understand CFR Part 2 very well so that we don't limit treatment or we don't share information that is not necessarily needed in order for the person to access treatment. So CFR 42 Part 2 applies to any individual or entity that is federally assisted and holds itself out as providing alcohol or substance use diagnosis, treatment, or referral for treatment. The information protected by 42 CFR Part 2 is any information that identifies an individual directly or indirectly as having a current or past drug or alcohol problem or as a participant in a covered program. Who is subject to 42 CFR Part 2? In order to be subject to 42 CFR Part 2, an entity or provider must be both federally assisted and meet the definition of a program. The provider is a program if it promotes itself as offering SUD services and provides or makes referrals for SUD services. For-profit programs and private practitioners who only accept private insurance or self-pay patients are not subject to 42 CFR Part 2 regulations except when licensed by the state of California, as described in the next paragraph. In California, under Section 10568C of Title IX of the California Code of Regulations, all information and records obtained from or regarding residents in residential or drug abuse recovery and treatment facilities licensed by DHCS shall be confidential and maintained in compliance with 42 CFR Part 2. Federally qualified healthcare centers, also known as FQHCs, licensed by DHCS as an alcoholism or drug abuse recovery or treatment facility, are also subject to 42 CFR Part 2. And we do have a link in many of these slides that offers you more information as well. Why 42 CFR Part 2 is important? Again, confidentiality is a cornerstone of any treatment program and relationship. So for individuals who are receiving treatment for substance use disorder, strict confidentiality protections means that information can be shared about past and current drug use without worrying about prosecution or any other consequences. Reducing the stigma and criminalization of those who are struggling with substance use means patients need the right to access treatment without the worry that their records will be used negatively and deprive them of their rights or freedoms. Records protected by 42 CFR Part 2. Upon request, patients who have consented using a general designation to disclose their SUD patient identifying health information must be provided a list of entities to whom their information has been disclosed. Under 42 CFR Part 2 regulations, a patient may use a designation of an individual and or entities, for example, my past and current treating physicians. They can request, the request must be in writing and limited to disclosures within the past 2 years. Each document disclosure must include the name of the entities, the date of the disclosure, and a brief description of the SUD patient identifying information that was disclosed. And here we just offered a resource, and this is directly from the State Health Information Guidance, also known as the SHIG, page 38. And this just helps kind of identify the difference between substance use disorder patient identifying information and mental health patient identifying information. And you can see what's regulated by 42 CFR Part 2 versus what's regulated by the LPS Act, so the Lantern and Petras Short Act, as well as what's protected by the California Health and Safety Code and the California Civil Code, so the CMIA. As well as under each box, you can see for HIPAA. So this category purpose is for treatment coordination of care. An example that they give is for a medical emergency. And so under substance use disorders, patient identifying information, so for under regulated by 42 CFR Part 2, substance use disorder information may be disclosed without a patient authorization for the purpose of treating a medical emergency and to qualified medical persons not employed by the treatment program to the extent necessary to meet a bona fide medical emergency. Under HIPAA, mental behavioral health information may be used or disclosed without patient authorization to facilitate treatment. The preemption consideration is HIPAA does not preempt the regulations listed above, but still applies. For mental health patient identifying information that's regulated by the LPS Act, mental health information may be shared for diagnosis and treatment, or behavioral health information may be used or disclosed without patient authorization to facilitate treatment. And it's the same for the HIPAA. So mental health and behavioral health information may be used or disclosed without patient authorization in order to facilitate treatment. And this is just another example. The category or purpose on this one is treatment of care, coordination of care. Treatment is not for a medical emergency. So substance use disorder, patient identifying information regulated by 42 CFR Part 2. Example is substance use disorder information can be disclosed to qualified personnel when needed for treatment within a program. Communications between a program and an entity that has direct administrative control of the program for treatment may occur without authorization, and in communications between qualified professional persons employed by the treatment or prevention program in the provision of service. On the mental health side, so mental health patient identifying information, which is regulated by the LPS Act, qualified professional persons having responsibility for the patient's care, whether internal or external to the facility, may share the patient's mental health information to provide treatment for referral or referral for treatment. Mental behavioral health information may be used or disclosed without patient authorization to facilitate treatment. And we do have these linked here in the slides. That way you can refer back to them further if you need to. Redisclosure of 42 CFR Part 2 regulated patient information. Behavioral health information regulated by 42 CFR Part 2 is specially protected and once received may only be redisclosed under specific conditions. SUD patient identifying information that has been disclosed in a response to a patient authorization must have an additional patient authorization to be redisclosed. One of the following written statements must accompany each disclosure of SUD patient identifying information made with patient authorization. The first one is, this record has been disclosed to you, is protected by federal confidentiality rules, 42 CFR Part 2. The federal rules prohibit you from making any further disclosure of this record unless further disclosure is expressly permitted by the written consent of the individual whose information is being disclosed in this record or is otherwise permitted by 42 CFR Part 2. A general authorization for the release of medical or other information is not sufficient for for this purpose. The federal rules restrict any use of this information to investigate or prosecute with regard to a crime any patient with a substance use disorder, except as provided at, and or 42 CFR Part 2 prohibits unauthorized disclosure of these records. So anytime there is a redisclosure, one of these two statements must be included or accompany each disclosure. All right. Coordinating with other delivery systems. Coordinating with schools. Oftentimes, as mobile crisis teams, we may respond to schools, and coordinating care with school personnel can be very essential, but oftentimes difficult. Sharing information with delivery systems like schools, either during or after a crisis, can be crucial. The best practice is to have consent to do so from the appropriate persons. However, in crisis cases, it's not necessary to have data sharing consent in the place across all providers. So in the instance of a crisis, if we don't have consent to data share across providers, so meaning a mobile crisis provider and let's say a school counselor, that's not necessarily required because this person is in crisis. And so that's one of those limits to the confidentiality that we discussed earlier. So when responding to schools for mobile crisis services, mobile crisis teams can coordinate with the school team if they are the referring party. Mobile crisis teams must follow all legal and ethical standards for student confidentiality and understand the limits to confidentiality in crisis situations. Within schools, they are bound by the Family Education Rights and Privacy Act, also known as FERPA. So the Family Educational Rights and Privacy Act is a federal law that protects the privacy of student education records. The law applies to all schools that receive funds under an applicable program of the U.S. Department of Education. Generally, schools must have written permission from the parent or eligible student to release any information from a student's education record. However, FERPA allows schools to disclose those records without consent to the following parties or under the following conditions. So appropriate officials in cases of health and safety emergencies and state and local authorities within a juvenile justice system pursuant to specific state law. All right, coordination with child and adult protective services. In some cases, you may have to coordinate with child or adult protective services to fulfill your obligation as a mandated reporter in California. Information obtained during the mobile crisis service encounter that obligates you to file a mandated report may be shared with the receiving entity as it pertains and is relevant to the report. We must always follow all legal and ethical standards for confidentiality and the limits to confidentiality, and we must abide by all legal, both federal and state standards for sharing PHI when we are mandated to report. Coordination with Child Protective Services. So child abuse or neglect mandated reporting. All persons who are mandated reporters are required by law to report all known or suspected cases of child abuse or neglect. It is not the job of the mandated reporter to determine whether the allegations are valid. If child abuse or neglect is reasonably suspected, or if a pupil shares information with a mandated reporter leading him or her to believe abuse or neglect has taken place, the report must be made. No supervisor or administrator can impede or inhibit a report or subject the reporting person to any sanction. Coordination with adult protective services. Elderly or dependent adult abuse or neglect reporting. A mandated reporter who is in their professional capacity or within the scope of their employment has observed or has knowledge of an incident that reasonably appears to be physical abuse as defined in section 15610.63, abandonment, abduction, isolation, financial abuse, or neglect, or is told by an elder or a dependent adult they have experienced behavior including an act of omission constituting physical abuse as defined in section 15610.63, abandonment, abduction, isolation, financial abuse, or neglect, or reasonably suspects that abuse shall report or reasonably suspects that abuse shall report the known or suspected instance of abuse by telephone or through a confidential internet reporting tool, as authorized by section 15658, immediately, as soon, or as practically as possible. Here we have a chart on the California minor consent laws in terms of mental health services here in California. You can see that there is the service treatment, so assessment, which falls under a mobile crisis team and within the scope of a mobile crisis team, as well as outpatient mental health treatment or counseling services. And here it talks about, minor consent. There are two statutes that give minors the right to consent to mental health treatment here in the state of California. If a minor meets the criteria either under the statute, the minor may consent to treatment. If the minor meets the criteria under both, the provider may decide which statute to apply. There are differences between them. So the Family Code 6924, a minor who is 12 years of age or older may consent to mental health treatment or counseling on an outpatient basis or to residential shelter services if both of the following requirements are satisfied. One, the minor, in the opinion of the attending professional person, is mature enough to participate intelligently in the outpatient services or residential shelter services. And two, the minor would present a danger of serious physical or mental harm to self or others without the mental health treatment or counseling or residential shelter services. Or B, is the alleged victim of incest or child abuse. And that is under the Family Code 6924. Under the Health and Safety Code 124260, a minor who is 12 years of age or older may consent to outpatient mental health treatment or counseling service if, in the opinion of the attending professional person, the minor is mature enough to participate intelligently in the mental health treatment or counseling services. If services are being provided by licensed interns or trainees, there may be obligations to consult with supervisors regarding provision of minor consent care. Then there's also information here on informing confidentiality obligations. And so this has to do with how do we inform and involve parents. So discretion to inform involved parents. The healthcare provider is required to involve a parent or guardian in the minor's outpatient treatment unless the healthcare provider decides that such involvement is inappropriate. This decision and any attempts to contact parents must be documented in the minor's record. When services are being provided under the Health and Safety Code 124260, providers must consult with the minor before making the determination concerning parental involvement. Involving parents in treatment will necessitate sharing certain confidential information. However, having them participate does not mean parents have a right to access confidential records. Providers should attempt to honor the minor's rights to confidentiality to the extent possible while still involving parents in treatment. And we do have a link here in this slide as well so that you can reference this further if needed. And now we're going to go through a couple case examples. David, can I hand this one off to you?
You sure can. Thank you, Danielle. Okay, so we're going to go over the first example is going to be scenario guidance. So here's the scenario buildup. It's a law enforcement official requesting information from a substance use disorder treatment facility. Employees of a publicly identified SUD treatment facility or component of a healthcare facility regulated by 42 CFR Part 2 and HSC 11845.5 are limited by law regarding the SUD patient identifying information where they can provide to a law enforcement officer, such as a police officer, sheriff's deputy, district attorney, or detective, without a valid authorization or a court order to release SUD patient information. Generally, no information may be released. Employees of a non-publicly identified SUD treatment facility or component of a healthcare facility not licensed by California Department of Healthcare Services, but regulated by 42 CFR Part 2, may acknowledge the presence of an individual. However, 42 CFR Part 2 regulations do not require entities to acknowledge that an individual is a patient. No other SUD patient identifying information may be disclosed without a valid authorization or court order. In any case, with a valid patient or patient's representative authorization, The SUD treatment facility may disclose the patient identifying health information. And this again is coming from the State Health Information Guidance, page 111.
Thank you, David. We have another case example. So the scenario guidance here is on public safety. A patient's psychotherapist has a responsibility per all mental health information privacy laws to warn potential victims. If the psychotherapist believes a patient presents a serious danger of violence, he or she may release limited mental health information to potential victims, law enforcement officials, or others when necessary, if the psychotherapist determines that disclosure is needed to protect the health and safety of persons. An SUD treatment provider only regulated by 42 CFR Part 2 may provide information that does not identify the patient as a person with an SUD or receiving treatment for SUD in order to warn potential victims, law enforcement, or others. In any case with a valid patient or patient's representative authorization, the mental health or SUD treatment facility may disclose the patient identifying information.
And so I'll take over from here. So scenario guidance. A patient is being released from an involuntary hospitalization. So employees of a mental health facility regulated by LPS are limited by law in the information they can provide to a law enforcement officer. Without a patient authorization or a court order to release information, an employee is allowed to disclose information to notify an LEO about release from a 72-hour hold. It also applies to a 14 or 30-day hold of a specific patient who is under criminal investigation. The employee may notify the LEO about the release of a patient who was involuntarily detained if all of the following conditions are met. The LEO to whom the disclosure is to be made initiated the written request for the hold. The LEO also requested in writing notification of release when the hold was initiated. The LEO certified in writing that the patient is alleged to have committed a crime. A notice from the facility employee to the LEO is limited to the person's name, address, admission date for evaluation, certification date for intensive treatment, if applicable, up to 14 or 30 additional days of treatment at the discretion of the facility's professional staff, the date of release. In any case, with a valid patient or patient's representative's authorization, the mental health facility may disclose the patient identifying information. And again, this comes from the State Health Information Guidance, page 114, link below.
Thank you, David. Mental health provider to health information organization, also known as HIO. The HIO and its participants must comply with the laws protecting the privacy of mental health information as it moves within and across the health information exchange. Mental health information and related information are specially protected. In most circumstances, mental health information may only be shared with the authorization of the patient or the patient's representative. Despite the restrictions, facilities and providers subject to LPS may share information with an HIO provided a business associate agreement is in place. The HIO must implement safeguards to protect the privacy and security of health information as required by HIPAA and California law. If the HIO does not have a BAA in place, the mental health information can be shared with a valid patient or patient's representative authorization to release information. And in summary, we are at the end. It is vital that mobile crisis teams understand the BHIN 23-025 requirements for maintaining privacy and confidentiality for individuals during mobile crisis encounters and beyond. Mobile crisis teams should understand the implications of HIPAA and 42 CFR Part 2 as healthcare providers in crisis situations. Mobile crisis teams are required to employ safeguards that respect an individual's right to confidentiality and privacy when possible. 42 CFR Part 2 is only applicable to any individual or an entity that is federally assisted and holds itself out as providing alcohol or substance use diagnosis, treatment, or referral for treatment, and the information protected by 42 CFR Part 2 is any information that identifies an individual directly or indirectly as having a current or past drug or alcohol problem, or as a participant in a covered program. Understanding legal standards for releasing and or exchanging information during crisis events supports smooth transitions of care and ensures an individual's safety when further treatment is needed. Understanding different systems of care and coordination with multiple providers during a crisis event and beyond supports mobile crisis teams with legal and ethical standards for maintaining privacy and confidentiality as appropriate. Here is a list of all references for today's training and slide deck. And there are links available to you for your reference. And thank you so much for joining us today and for completing the training. And if you have any questions or need to contact us, please feel free to do so. You can email us for general questions at mobilecrisisinfo@cars-rp.org. You can also reach us directly here, and you can see our emails under our names. Again, thank you for joining us and have a great day.